Hello there. I welcome you to yet another episode of Checkpoint, and this is the Women's Month. And I'm very honored and privileged to host Honorable Dr. Miria Rukoza Kobulunga Matembe. I had to capture all those for purposes of the conversation we're going to have. She is a senior citizen and political evangelist in Uganda and, of course, the world over. She's been a champion of social justice and women empowerment. She has been a strong proponent for and an advocate of women's rights in Uganda. There's a very particular quote from her that I really always love to remind myself about. She says, "My passion is for gender equality and women empowerment. Everybody that God created was given a purpose and is to fight for justice." A very good evening and welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, my dear sister.
This, your quote about your passion for gender equality, is one of the many reasons we are seated here. And how has that journey been for you when you look back?
Let me tell you, I sit here with a full sense of accomplishment. Because the journey for gender equality and women's empowerment is not a journey that I will live to see end. It is a journey which we live on and on and on until God calls all whoever have participated in this journey to be with Him. So, when you say, what do you feel now? When I look back, at the time I was 9 years, when I made up my mind that when I grow up, I'll study law. Why was I intending to study law? Because as I lived in the village as a peasant girl, not only did I witness gender inequalities, injustices, and discrimination, but I experienced them personally. As a young child, 6 years, 7 years, 8 years, in my mind, I was with this burning, confusing question. Why? Why are girls treated like this? Why are women treated like this? It's not fair. It's not good. As a young girl. And that's what shaped my childhood dream to fight for gender equality and women's empowerment. Because down the road, I came to learn that, you know, women and girls are like that. Mm-hmm. In other words, they are not full human beings in their own right. And therefore, for them, they are like that. And then by the time I was 9 years, I came to know that there is a person called a pleader.
Yes.
The pleader, I asked how, who is a pleader? They said a pleader is that person who pleads for others. And how I came to know about it, you know, those days, murder you see here, a person to die in the village was like, no imaginable. So one time I think a man, somebody killed somebody, and then they were talking, they said, Ogonaja gura pleader. In other words, that will buy a pleader. I said, who is a pleader? They said a pleader is that person who pleads for others. I said, I want to be a pleader because I want to plead for the women and girls. So I said, what does she need? They said she needs to study law. So at 9 years, I determined I will study law and see what the law says about these women. And by the time I went to HSC, that's when my dream was expanded, enlarged to include becoming a member of parliament. Because I wanted to study law and see what it says about this situation. And when I see it, then I would call women. I was always with this burning fire in my heart to call women and girls in my village. Even if we stood on a high hill and I said, you come, let us fight, we are cheated. This is not fair. So that's All along, I was in O-level HSC. Then when I reached at HSC, we studied British parliamentary history, and they were debating. That's when I learned that the law is made in parliament. Then I enlarged my dream, and I said, when I finish law, I'll go to parliament. Mm-hmm. And then when I find these laws are not good, I go to parliament and make good laws. Now, the story is long, yes, but that's why I tell you that I sit here as a fully accomplished woman of destiny who has been able to realize the dream to become a lawyer, to become a member of parliament, and not only to become a member of parliament to make the law, but to be one of the 21 member commission, Uganda Constitutional Commission, that made the Constitution of Uganda. Mm-hmm. Let me tell you, the day I received the Constitution in my hand, having worked day and night to ensure that it is gender sensitive and gender responsive, I acted like, you know, this man, they call him Simeon, when he saw Jesus brought for baptism in church and he held the baby, he said, God, you can take your servant in peace. Right. But instead, I behaved like Hannah, who said, I must stay and talk about Jesus. So, how can you go and have a dream? I had thought that I would call people in the women in the village. Little did I know that one day I would stand on a national platform talking about gender equality and women's rights. I would stand on a regional platform at Pan-African Parliament and everywhere, and I would stand at the international platform in Washington, in America, in Beijing, espousing the issue for gender equality and women's empowerment. Now, what haven't I done? What haven't I seen? Formed non-government organizations, both at regional and national. Let me tell you, as I walk everywhere in this country, people are saying, Mama, Mama, the young girls, you are my role model. I'm your mentee. You are my role model. I mean, what do I want? That's why I say, people who listen to me, that guy, life does not exist in positions and possessions. Right now, I don't have positions. I don't have many possessions, but I enjoy life because I know God was gracious enough to enable me to realize my dream, and I have seen the journey start, and people are walking on this journey, both men and women, despite the challenges, despite constraints. I can assure you, we can never go back.
Absolutely.
We can never go back,
indeed. Though you mentioned that it is a journey that is probably never ending, and you have previously slammed women and girls for undermining their own cause. You usually tell them, sometimes girls, we compound ourselves in a certain, you know, we put ourselves under a certain tree and we're like, ah, we are girls, some of these things we can't
do. As far as I'm concerned, that's nonsense. Because let me tell you, for me, you can imagine a village girl. I have always told my story. And let me tell you, recently we had Dr. Hilda Tadria launching her book, Stand.
Yes, yes.
She told her story. I have read Rhoda Karema's story. I have read Joyce Mpanga's story. Those were distinguished women. Let me tell you, they were distinguished women from distinguished families. They never suffered what I suffered. They never saw what I saw. They never developed that passion of resistance. And that's why I found a difference. I don't know, why am I who I am? Kumbe, the experience that I lived was turning me into the real purpose that God had created me for. Purposely, I'm on this earth to fight for against injustice, discrimination, unfairness, and cheating, but passing the woman path. So, I could be like that village rural girl who'd say, well, what do we do? But do you know that my parents wanted to withdraw me from school when I was at 14 years to give opportunity to the boy? I resisted. I refused and went and got my what? My bursary for myself. When I was going to university, my father said, no, you are not going to study law. Women don't study law. I will ostracize you. I resisted him. If I could do that in 60s and 70s, when nobody was shouting out loud, when there was no loud voice talk for women being also human beings like others, now that we have been there for even more than 30, 40 years, shouting out this, why should any girl, now demean herself and say that they cannot do it? Why should they?
How can they? What would you tell them to focus on? Because most girls these days, we are focused on other things. There's this, there's that. We want to get married. We want to
you
get
know what rich. Has caused this is complacency. You know, complacency can be very bad. Because let me tell you, if I tell you that in 1973, my father was refusing me to study law. Is there any girl now in this country who can't study any course they want?
No.
Ah, we achieved it for them. So after achieving it for them, they think it is automatic. They don't think they would struggle. When we brought 1.5 at Makerere, we were bringing it against a background. Look here. Here I was, for instance, my experience. When I was studying with this boy, my brother I was following. And 3 days I don't go to school. When there is no school fees, I don't go there for about a month. And for him, he's going there all the time. And yet I was expected to perform as equal as well. Thank God I did better and did better completely, because the spirit of the Lord was within me to espouse the cause for gender equality and women's empowerment. Now, it's again such background that we said, no, in 1987-89 there, we in Oxford and university women, we said, look here, the challenges and discrimination and unfairness and injustices girls face in school. If a girl can be able to get two principles required for Makerere. If she can get two, whether from the village, whether from the town, the challenges she has faced against men, she has passed. And therefore, we should bridge the gap of inequalities by adding 1.5 to everybody who gets the minimum pass.
And so now we are comfortable.
We pushed it, we got it, and they got 1.5, and therefore the universities and institutions of higher learning started getting all these women. We had shouted through FIDA, through Oxford, through university women, through all the channels that we had, adding on the NRIM when they came to power with the woman question high on the agenda. We embraced all the political environment and the political will that was then there to make them get what they would not be. You see them now, they do everything. Computer expert, flight engineer. Now they don't know that we fought for them. And now it's time we have handed over the mantle that they must, instead of sitting and relaxing, they must pursue the journey for the others. Because when you sit and relax, there is a tendency to slug back.
So how can these young girls consolidate these achievements?
But aren't we talking to them? I mean, look here. Uh-huh. We talk to them, they don't care.
Yeah, don't.
And the problem is the political environment has become less conducive. It is now violent. The political will is not there anymore. The political will right now is to just use girls, put them in positions of power without power, so that they are busy serving power. Therefore, the environment is different. Secondly, the ethical value system, the moral degeneration and ethical value breakdown,
yes,
has caused women to go back. Let me tell you, in fact, when I was castigating them, I was saying women who are below 40 years are disappointing me. Because now, for us, when we are struggling, fighting, I made up my mind that I will not marry a man who has property. I married in 75, actually, when I had finished second year at Makerere. But I had resolved, I'm not marrying a person who has a car, I'm not marrying a man who has a house. I'm not marrying a man who has property, because he will say, my house, my car, my property.
Story.
So where will mine be? So I said, I will marry this man as long as he's a graduate. Mm-hmm. He has a job. I have a job. We shall work and make our things together. You know, I'm a different brand of a person, I am telling
That's
you.
True.
I'm not here to hail myself. But you can imagine people were running with women, with men with cars, and I would look at them and say, trash.
It's a different story now.
You have guys, gone back.
Yes.
Yeah, you've gone back to that time, and they tell me, well, you know, one time I was training young women. I was so shocked when I was training this youth. Uganda Youth Network. Mm. I was training them in leadership. And they told me the story of, oh my goodness, what was it?
We can't walk around with
men. Oh, that thing was important to me. It was like, when I explained to you, is it love for service? Is it friendship for benefit? They told
friends
me,
benefits.
Friends for benefit. I asked them, what does that mean? Mm-hmm. They told me, you have this man, he's your friend, mm-hmm. but for benefit.
Yes.
I said, which benefit? He said, you see, you go there, you prepare food, you cook, you wash his clothes, you clean the house, and she gives you some kamani. You sleep, yeah. She gives you some kamani, you are benefited, yeah. He has benefited.
And
I said, what? Then they said, but he has his girlfriend. So I asked them, so tomorrow when the girlfriend finds you there, you don't notice her. You meet her on the, you don't care. I said, are you animals? That's when I realized that girls had become animals. Because what about the feelings in your heart? What, are you just a chattel to be climbed for benefit? I don't know. I was so shocked, but they laughed at me. I don't know whether that thing is still there.
Oh, no,
if it is still there, I cast it in the name of Jesus, and
I cast it down.
I rebuke it in the name of Jesus.
Let me tell you,
I am glad my daughters can never do that.
Amen. But let me tell you, doctor, this is the trend. This is the trend. Girls, a girl will not date you unless you have a car, unless you have property somewhere, unless you're going to fly her to Dubai, and you know.
Then let them rot. What do you want Matembe to do? I set the pace. I put the journey.
I know.
No, what do you want me to do? If they are like that, let them go and rot. But at least I know there are some.
Yes.
Because I have my girls whom I mentor.
Mm-hmm.
I know who they are.
Absolutely.
They can't go into nonsense.
How do we continue this journey? How do we continue championing the girl child movement without neglecting the boy child?
No, nobody has ever neglected a boy child. Mm. And I don't want actually some people who are detractors over our struggle, they bring in that. They say now women are more empowered, the men are disempowered. I say, is there any culture? Is there any religious practice? Is there any custom? Is there any law which discriminates against a boy child? Is it there?
I have not heard of
it. It is not there. The reason why we came up to fight for the girl's empowerment was because she is discriminated against mm-hmm. by customs and cultural practices, by religious misinterpretation and misapplication, by discriminatory laws, by poverty, by so many things, and nor by ignorance, because of discrimination, they don't take them to school, and because of not taking them to school, they don't become knowledgeable enough to get jobs and fight poverty. So all those barriers had conspired together to pin a girl down and make her as if she's not a human being. Now, when we got out to fight, we are not fighting men. We are not fighting against boys. We were focusing on breaking the barriers that prevent women, that constrain girl children from using their talents and their God-given wisdom to realize their potential, which they have. So we were fighting against those barriers, those institutional structures, patriotism. That's what we are fighting, to free the girl. So by freeing the girl from prison, You have not put a boy in prison. Let's look at it as a prison. The girl was imprisoned by culture. She's a prison in culture, ignorance, poverty, racial discrimination, and so on. In the meantime, the boy is free. He's called a boy. You are a boy. You are a man. He's promoted. He's, you know, but the girl is in prison. Now, when we fight and get the girls out of prison, do we put there the boys?
No.
So why should they be disempowered?
Some of them put themselves
Why
there.
Should they be disempowered? So for me, this whole idea of you are empowering boy, you empower boy. The parents, let me tell you, the parents of both girls and boys are responsible for bringing up their children in the right way. Now, if the men, if men these days are just redundant, they just go drinking. In fact, generally, let me tell you, I want to tell everybody listening to me and tell them why they should really focus at empowering the girl child. Because it is women who make up homes. It is women. I am telling you.
I want us to come to that conversation. But you bring out something very important. Feminism, the idea of feminism. Now, let me quote you. You say, generally, I am a woman activist. We call ourselves activists, but in the real sense, we are feminists. But we fear using the word for the connotation it brings in our continent. Because people think when you are a feminist, you are a rebel who is busy breaking down marriages and destroying families. Is this not true, though?
Well, I said that statement, I think, long ago.
Yes.
And all along, people knew I refused to call myself a feminist. Because by that time, I went on to the public scene, actually, when I shouted about women's rights, the accusation I got, that woman has now learned from those white people. And she's coming here to destabilize society. And yet I tell you, by the time I made up my mind that I will fight for women in Rutoma village, I had never seen a white woman. You don't need to be white, not be a European, to know that actually you are oppressed, you are discriminated against, you are treated unjustly. But that was the accusation. But why they brought it is because by the time for us, we came here to talk about to gender equality and women's empowerment. By then, actually, we were talking about women's rights. The terms came later. This gender equality and so on came later. Me, I was actually calling myself a self-styled advocate for women's rights. That's what I used to call myself. Because those people started their struggles also like ours long ago. They started long ago and they were facing all that resistance, and all they were struggling for is for them to have rights. Because what does a feminist mean? Actually, a feminist means looking at the world through a woman's angle.
Yeah.
I mean, that's how I define it. Because it looks at a woman as a human being and looks, if you are a woman, how would the world be? How would you look at the world?
What would you say of our current feminists?
Now, this whole idea of not calling myself a feminist brought this journey go long and long and long. Now, with our young generation, for them, they have come out running out with this word feminist.
Yes.
So they call themselves feminist. And for me, many of these girls who call themselves feminist, I don't know where they for them, they decided to use the word.
It's a fancy word.
They decided to use the word, but while they are using the word, in the midst of the environment which has now changed, they are not looking at it in relation to our context. I have a young girl whom I'm mentoring. She's now at university, fourth year student at UCC. She's called Fiona Ayukoro. I listened to her defining what feminism means within the context of the African people. And I said, wow, I'm glad you are my daughter.
Wow.
Because you've got to know, if you go saying, if you copy the ways of the Europeans, the ways of those developed countries, when for you have not reached. You know, you have to walk a journey. A journey must be put within the context at whichever stage. You know, when I was telling people in my village, in the constituency, I used to tell them, I didn't want to jump at the boys have roles, men have roles, girls must do this, boys must do this. I didn't want to jump at that. All I was saying was, a woman is a human being. She also has rights and she has responsibilities. If it is her responsibility to make the bed, it is her right to sleep in it comfortably. If it is her responsibility to cook the food, let her sit at the table and eat it well with the family, not being chased out, not being beaten. So my focus was on what? On rights, rights. And therefore, it did not challenge. I managed to win the struggle together with my colleagues because we are perceiving it and placing it within the context. And I didn't have to tell Matembe to go and make a bed. But the moment I enjoyed my rights of being a member of parliament and coming late in the home, inevitably the bed had to be made. They had to be made. I didn't tell him to take care of the babies. Yes. But the moment I got my right to be late in the office and work, and I come back, she has already fed the children. And that's how we captured it. Mm-hmm. That's how we managed to do well with it. When I bring it into the current context, that's why I tell the young men that you young man, you don't think you'll come and marry Matembe's daughter. And you go, together of you go and work. You come home when you are all tired. You sit at the TV and she goes to the kitchen, she cooks the food, she's bathing the baby, she's doing all this. Don't think she will do it.
She won't
do it. And she won't do it because she's a feminist. She won't do it because as a person who is also entitled to her rights to work.
As a human being,
the responsibilities within the home must be a shift. Attitudinal shift, yes. And there must be wisdom, and there must be understanding and love between one another. Here I am, I'm going to work. When I bring the money, I pay school fees, you are buying a uniform for the children, or you are buying food. So we are contributing to this home. Since we are contributing to this home, the roles must change. For me, I have always told people that the only role that I see not changing, even these people who are making men women, even these Waizaka people who are turning men into women, who are taking God's role, those ungodly people who are usurping a godly role and changing men into women, they are not even giving them uterus. They don't have uterus to produce babies. So that's why I say that the different role I see between a man and woman is that the woman is blessed with the uterus where to incubate the human being.
Right. Eh? Right.
And that one you can't get the man
you
do it.
Get it.
But after pushing the baby out and the baby is there, the only thing the man cannot do is to breastfeed, to give the baby breast.
But the rest
of the things she can do. Bathing the baby, feeding the baby. I cannot tell you when I married when I had not even gone into this battle for gender equality and women's empowerment because the environment was not there. My story is long, but I married Matembe when I had finished the second year, and by the end of the next year, I had produced a baby.
Wow.
And I fed that baby 3 months.
Eh? And then went to work.
And I left the baby there. I was still studying Law Development Center. That man, at 1.5 months, he was mixing the bottle. He used to mix, you know, he was a chemist working in Uganda breweries. He almost brewed the milk. Because he used to mix this milk and put in the fridge and come back home to warm the milk and make sure the baby is taking the milk. And our firstborn Godwin is a super accountant, SCCA. He's now married with his wife, Christine. They have two children, daughter and son, but everybody cooks, everybody washes, everybody does everything together.
I thank you for that because I wanted to ask, and I will still ask, we need to take a break. But before, let's go with this. Is women empowerment good for marital and family stability?
I want to ask you. Mm-hmm. It is the best you can have. Women's empowerment, women's equality and empowerment is the best you can have for a family. Okay. Because mm-hmm. everybody contributes to the maintenance, everybody earns, everybody, they are all sharing. Because if they have equal rights and equal responsibilities and they participate in decision making, the woman puts her ideas, the man puts their ideas, they come out with a project, they do it together, they share the income, instead of the man suffering every day working 24 hours to buy dresses and clothes and pay school fees for one for children.
Thank you. Let's take a break. I love that conversation where we've stopped it. Let's take a break. When we return, we have the doctor clarifying on how women empowerment is good for marital and family stability. I know most of you are like, what are you even talking about? We'll be right back.